God the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. 2 Peter 3 and 15 says, an account of the longsuffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul also, according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you. You know what that's telling us tonight? That God has been patient with us, even when we have said we do not want to believe. God has long-suffered with us, even when we knew we should have repented to be saved, but turned him away.
Yeah.
There's nobody else that I know on earth that if I continue to wrong them, that they would be patient and love me through all of it. The only person I have met and have got a relationship with that has loved me regardless of where I was is God. And without that love and relationship in our life, let me tell you, you're going to wear people out. You're going to wear out people's trust. You're going to wear out the relationships of those around you. People are going to get tired of hearing your sad story. They're going to lose their compassion to want to help you. But I want to open your eyes tonight and help you see that even when everybody else has gotten over what you're going through, God still understands. I want to preach to you tonight that even though you might feel abandoned with what you're dealing with, that even in the midst of your endurance, God is still with you and is being patient with you to let you be strong. You wouldn't even be on the seat. Move around while you're on your seat just a little bit. You wouldn't even be on the seat that you're sitting on if God had not gave you the opportunity to be here. You wouldn't have had the privilege to get from point A to point B. For me, it's a little bit of a longer drive on the interstate, and I drive around a lot of foolishness. If you text and drive, you're foolish. I'm going to go ahead and tell you. But I drive around a lot of people that almost put themselves in harm's way just to get a message across. So when I get here, I say, thank you, God, for watching over me. Glory to God. Because he's telling you something. He's sending you a message. He's trying to open your eyes to get you to understand. When everybody else will fail you, when all your resources are finally gone and you're down to the bottom of the barrel, that there's still somebody that's willing to take you just as you are, to pick you up out of the miry clay and form you into an individual that can be happy again. I'm glad he's long-suffering with us, because you know what? If this wasn't in place of employment, we'd all be fired. Oh yeah, I said it. You knew it was coming. It is by his loving presence and patience toward us that while we are into things that we should face punishment and exposure for, that we receive mercy instead. Even when we have not apologized for the things that we have done, God is still merciful. He still looks over our issues in hopes that we'll begin to see the greater truth. Here's what I've learned in the past 15 years. There is no drug on earth that is greater than God. There is no amount of money you can have that is going to out and overdo what God can do for you. There is no amount of friends on social media that can compare to having the closeness of God in your life. There is no relationship, no food that you can eat, no place that you can behold with your eyes that is greater than having God with you and having that relationship in your life. There's nothing greater. Is there anybody tonight that can testify to the fact that there's nothing greater than God? Let me hear you. I'm was some kind of wool or garment that he wore at the time. Think about how hot he was. Think about how bad he probably smelled too after he sweat out there. He's out there and he was trying to get people's attention. You know what he was saying? Repent!
Look
Look over and tell your neighbor, say, don't mess yourself. Oh yeah, I said it right. Because let me tell you, when you do it your way, you're going to be a mess. You're going to be a hot, sweaty, unorganized, full of chaos, cross-thoughted, bent every which way, having no idea what you need to do, where you need to go. Trying to cover up the pain with pills, trying to cover up the pain with alcohol, trying to cover up the pain with methamphetamine or anything, trying to cover up the pain with pornography, trying to fill your loneliness any other way. But at the end of the day, if you're going to be honest with me tonight and be a real human being, you've got to admit to yourself, without God, I'm a mess.
Christ is our Savior, we are no longer alone.
Isn't that wonderful? Aren't you glad you're not alone? Aren't you glad at the midnight hour that you are not alone? It's a treasure to know Him. But it's even more valuable when you know He's with you. Friends, we all have been weary and wayward because guess what? When you set out to do something good, evil is always present. And when you put one evil down, the Bible says it's going to come out seven times stronger in another area. So unless you are aware and active, you will be surprised, overtaken, and sometimes even beat down to the bottom. But even then, God doesn't leave you. We have got to learn from our mistakes. Listen, I have had to learn to get out of disobedience. You, brother, you've been preaching to me forever. You mean you have to battle disobedience? Yeah. It's not easy to commit yourself to say, I'm ready to preach every single night I go to church. Oh, you think it's easy? I giggle. I giggle. We think it's easy when we see somebody else do it. But when the moment comes and God's calling you, think about how hard it feels inside to take that next step. And for a long time I struggled with that. Because it seemed like the first step off the ledge seemed impossible for me to take. Only until I realized that every step that I would launch out to take, that He was with me. Until I had that confidence and trust in God, I never took a move. I never made a move. I never said the first word. But as I took this journey with Him, the more I accept His will and trust Him, then I don't worry about the material. I don't worry about what He's going to give us next week. I have no concern because I know if I take that step with Him, He'll be with me. And you might think that just applies to the preacher, but guess what? We're going to get to your bathroom. We're going to your bedroom. We're going to your vehicle. When you begin to doubt yourself, you're limiting your faith potential. You don't need to be going to your job dreading every single day. You need to give your dread to God and pick up faith.
Yes.
Nod with me. Get a good nod.
Yes.
You need to lay off whatever holds you down and pick up your faith. Because if you go into your job with dread, there won't be any coffee good enough for you. There won't be anybody you can find to talk to that will satisfy you. There won't be any text message we can send that will bring satisfaction. There won't be anything that will satisfy greater than God. So we've got to learn, okay, obviously, God, you did not put in me a spirit of dread. So I can't live in dread. And I've got to surrender to you what is not like you. Because guess what? The reality is this. If our destination is a place where we will rejoice evermore, then there's not going to be a frown in heaven. There's not going to be sickness there. No longer to grieve our loved ones that we lose anymore. No longer dreading, wondering if cancer is going to be on our next doctor report. All of these worries of if I'm going to be able to make ends meet to pay the bills and keep the lights on will finally be behind us. So I realize that if we're going to a place where we can rejoice evermore, and He's created a relationship with us today, then that means what is there is here.
Amen.
Don't get up and sing, I'm going to be happy over there, and have a frown. All right? Don't get up and try to preach people into joy when you can't stand them. Don't try to encourage people to be strong in the Lord when the first thing that happens, you tell them off. Don't be that guy. You know what the Bible calls that? The hypocrite. Listen, you can make more of a difference being genuine and just admitting, hey, you know what? I stumble sometimes, but I let God help me. You can make more of a difference than that than coming in, oh my Lord, anything wrong with me, brother? Ask me how I'm doing.
How are you doing?
All the skies are blue. All the grass is green. The flowers, they smell so wonderful. It's glorious. but you have debts you can't pay. So what? Everything's wonderful.
You ain't fooling nobody. You hear me? You ain't fooling nobody. Pardon my double negative. You are not fooling anyone, said that.
I went for a long time trying to deny the fact that I needed to change anything.
Well, I thought, well, if God loves me, then he loves me.
But I woke up every day miserable, looking for my next fix, looking for my next drink, looking for the next party to go to, because the best way I can describe it is I felt empty with no sense of direction. And you've probably heard churches say all your life, and we get so comfortable being in church and it being church that we just say people are lost. We're not trying to segregate you, but I'm here, let me explain what lost means. It just simply means you're without direction. You don't know where you're going. We're not here to condemn you, to make you feel less of who you can be. I'm here to empower you and tell you, we have a God that can give us direction. We have a God that can open our eyes and show us the way. As a software programmer, God inspires me and helps me to do my job. I bet you didn't see God as a computer programmer, did you? Some of you might be working in sales, and I bet God anoints you to be great salesmen and women out there, right? Nobody would ever thought that God would be walking with you in the trenches of sales. Maybe some of you have worked in telemarketing or had to take service calls from people that were very unsatisfied with their service, and you've had to have patience. You didn't have that patience on your own. Every good thing is from God. Maybe you've had some times where you were, as we say, overworked and underpaid and felt like that you just weren't getting anything together. But listen, friends, you wouldn't have anything unless God gave it to you. So whether we want to acknowledge he exists, whether we know he exists and we want to deny him, or whether we are accepting him as our Savior, he said he never leaves us. Amen. We're about to read that. Can I read this to you? Can we go on? We're ready to go. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. There hath no temptation taken you but such as common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will the temptation also make a way to escape that you may be able to bear it. Matthew 11 and 29 says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find what? Rest unto your souls. Let me go ahead and continue. 2 Peter 1 and 3. According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. You know what that's saying? God has already given you everything you're ever going to need to be an effective Christian. You have no need to ask for more. You already have everything you need to be effective. You don't need more money to be a great Christian. You don't need a bigger church to be a good Christian. You don't need a deacon board to be a great Christian. You can be an effective Christian with what God has already supplied in your life from the moment you accepted him. Amen. Guess what? That means freedom from sin. How many of you are glad you're free? Amen. Yes, sir, glad. How many of you are glad you're free? I know we're getting towards the latter end, and our nodding's starting to come along. And our tummies are beginning to communicate to us that it's time for our late evening meal. By the way, if you don't have a meal, go to Taco Bell, get the Captain Crunch Bites with icing in the middle. They're delightful, I believe. So now that we've got the food conversation out of the way, can I finish the rest of this? Think about that. God loved us enough to already give us everything we need to be effective Christians. Guess what? We already have more than enough in here to have a great church. And I am very proud of all of those that are stepping up. And I'm not shortchanging you. I'm going to give you honor right now. I'm proud of each and every one of you that are coming and being active and participating and doing your part. It means the world to me, and I couldn't do this without having your help. We can't do this unless we bond together with each other. And let me tell you something. You can either come in and be a part of the greater body, or you can suffer in a click. It's up to you. All that I know is I'm going to get where the fire's at. This is Christians that have blogs they have started to write about other evangelists that they disagree with. Have you seen these? They look like Christian blogs, but then you start getting into it and they're not a blog at all. They're just taking on their brother. There's probably been people that have come to 13th Street before and heard me preach and was so appalled by me that it got them back on fire for God for like 3 weeks thinking about what I preached on. And I think to myself, well, God, if I got to them that way, at least I made a difference somehow. You might think your toes hurt when the sermon's over, but I'm walking around without any because God's already took all mine out by digging me up and causing me to have to change. Can't be a first fruit bearer, don't bother to preach. If you're not going to accept what you're telling people, don't bother. Don't even try, because you're not going to be effective. You've got to learn to apply what God's telling you. So I'm beginning to see that in my own life, that Lord, if you've already given me everything I need, then I understand greater when it says, be content with such as you have. It's not talking about material things. It's talking about what God has done in your life. Because if you can be content with that, you won't worry over the other things. We talked about this Friday. When they spoke to the rich man and said, sell everything you had, it had nothing to do with his money. It had everything to do with the condition of his heart. And that's where God's wanting to talk to and speak to and work with in your life. He doesn't want you to be weary in heart. He doesn't want you to walk in fear or have anxiety. Anxiety is at an all-time high. How many of you admit that you get anxious over wondering what's coming? We all have anxiety. But guess what? I have to go there. I'm sorry. I've got to burst your bubble. We can be delivered from anxiety. You don't have to let anxiety be the gateway and open door to fear. For God did not put on us the spirit of fear, but of power. Now, let me read this from last scripture. Somebody could, I would ask they come and go ahead and get a song ready. Let me read this last part to you. I appreciate your attention. It means the world to me that you are here with us. God loves us enough, pay attention to this, that irregardless of what we have done prior to this very moment right now, that if we come to Him and ask forgiveness of our mistakes, and accept that Jesus Christ died for us, that by accepting Him, we receive salvation and eternal life.
Yes.
Amen.
When God found me, I had nothing. Amen. But when I accepted Him, I gained it all.
Amen.
Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10 says, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thine heart that God hath raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved.
Amen.
Yes. Isn't that wonderful?
Amen.
Many of you saved in here tonight say, I am.
I am.
I know you are. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. That means as you accept Him and believe Him, He's going to cause your life to come into alignment.
Yes.
Teach you to live better. And with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. That means you won't be afraid to tell somebody that you're no longer how you used to be.
Amen.
You'll be proud to tell them that you are a different person.
Amen.
I can't wait to talk to people and tell them about what God has done for me. Sometimes I almost want to get ashamed about how dark those days were. But God has shown me that my humbleness comes from remembering just how far down I was. And that helps me to preach every single sermon. I'm here to tell you, without that dark place, I wouldn't be able to endure and continue. And without the dark places you have been through, how could we celebrate anything? Not only forgiveness and freedom of our past is rewarded, but here's the best part for you. We also receive power by the Holy Ghost to have a present authority to write a new chapter of a bright and marvelous future. He said signs, wonders, and miracles would follow us.
Yes.
And I don't know if you see them behind me. You may not see them as I walk, but I have miracles walking with me.
Yes.
You might not see them physically. physically with your eyes, but I have signs and wonders that are with me. Because when I hurt, I don't give up. When I struggle, I hold on. When all the storms around me are raging, I don't give up. God wants to change you, that you write a new chapter. Behold, all things are become new. Old things are dead. They're passed away. You don't have to be the person that you are right now anymore. If you accept Christ in your life, or if you have Him and accept more of Him, you can be an individual you never thought or dreamed that you could be. I went from being an introvert personality. Introvert meaning I'll be the guy in the corner that never talks to anybody. I went from being an introvert personality to God giving me the ability to speak publicly. This is not something I was born with. It was something He blessed me to have. I would not be able to talk to you right now and have confidence in what I'm telling you unless God had given it to me. And my words wouldn't have any worth, weight, or value unless what God did for me was lasting and continual. I'm not in the hog pen anymore. And if you're in there wallowing, as they say, it's time to get up.